Congratulations, Duke. You just saved Paris. Or at least most of it.
Sienna Miller, good morning. Welcome back.
Thank you.
I'm fine. Thank you. I'm trying to imagine the conversation with your agent when he or she comes to you and says, okay, forget the indie films. Put that over here for a second. This is a blockbuster in the true Hollywood tradition. What do you think?
I mean, I realized it was a really big, big movie, but I kind of wanted to do something that was just about pure entertainment and having fun. And I got to learn how to fight. I got to learn how to fire guns. And it was just, I think I was quite exhausted by my own choices at that point, and I just wanted to do entertainment.
You said in some interview, you said, I wanted to do a movie for a change that would actually, people would want to see, which is somewhat downplaying what you've done in the past.
No,
because
I say a lot of things with kind of attempted irony,
tongue-in-cheek.
And it doesn't translate. I mean, you know, independent films are what I love watching and making fundamentally, but it's also great to be in something that people are really genuinely excited about seeing.
So was this also tongue-in-cheek when you told somebody in an interview that for the first month or so of shooting G.I. Joe, you went to your dressing room every night and just cried, just broke out crying?
I mean, it's definitely, definitely exaggerated. I was intimidated at first.
Intimidated by what? The scope of it?
Well, it was a crew of 1,000, and it was enormous sets, and there was a button on the wall, and if you pushed it, it actually, something lit up. I mean, I was used to sharing a car to work, and it was, you know, a very different environment, but
so is there a downside to it as well? I mean, it, you know, obviously you've got everything at your disposal. You pick up the phone and things happen. But is there a negative side to it?
Nothing at all. It's just, it was just huge. It just felt initially intimidating. And once I realized what I was in, I had a great time.
Now, you wear black leather through most of this movie.
Yes.
I don't have a question there. I just wanted to say that. I don't know why. What was it like to get you in this getup every day?
It was quite uncomfortable.
Was it really?
It was skin tight, you know, leather.
So you had a team of people dressing you?
I had three women, kind of, and it involved lying down and shimmying in and then hopping up and down to get the trousers. And then the last act of the film, actually, I'm soaking wet, and leather doesn't dry overnight. So 5 a.m. wet leather was really fun.
And so when you looked at yourself in the mirror when you were in your getup every day, and not only with the black leather but the brunette side of things, how'd you like, what'd you think of that?
I laughed.
You laughed?
No,
you like yourself better as a blonde?
No, it was just, you know, it's fun. It's a really fun role. And the outfit was kind of extraordinary. And I wore a wig, so I got to be blonde at night.
Well, the nice thing about a blockbuster is you don't have to promote it a lot. You basically do one interview, and that suffices.
They just do one generic, and then they just send it.
You've already traveled around the world for this, haven't you? You are coming to New York, and you're going to be on Broadway.
In 2 weeks, I'm moving to New York.
Talk to me about that and how nerve-wracking that is.
It's nerve-wracking, but it's the most exciting thing. You know, I'm from England, obviously, and we have such a huge theater culture there. And for me, to be on Broadway is just a dream come true.
Have you done a lot of theater?
I did a play in the West End in London, a Shakespeare play, but never here.
I mean, because it's no cut, second
Broadway.
Take. Yeah.
I
mean, so what's it going to be like to see
I
your
keep
name?
I keep going Broadway, but actually it's a really depressing play, and I kill myself at the end. But it's like Broadway.
Oh, you just gave away the ending of the play.
It's a famous, well, it's based on a Strindberg play called Miss Julie, and it's called After Miss Julie. But it's an amazing drama, really incredible play.
What's it going to be like when you see your name up on the market?
I mean,
that's
got to
be.
It's gone up.
It's already up. You've got
to
drive over there. Yeah. It's just down the block.
I know.
That's a major event for most actors and actresses when they see it up on Broadway.
Yeah. I can't wait. I actually am going to go after this.
You said to someone you were looking for some New York friends.
You offering that?
I was going to say, we've got a crew. We've got, I'm surprised the line hasn't formed here.
I have lots of New York friends. I say a lot.
You know, that's your answer to everything here. I talk a lot,
Matt. I say the first thing that comes into my head, and then obviously it doesn't often translate to print.
Well, last time you were here, we joked. We didn't really joke because it was serious, but you were trying to quit smoking. And so this time you are still technically trying to quit smoking?
Have you heard me coughing through this interview?
Are you still? Yeah?
All right,
I don't want to make a big deal of it.
No, it's a tough one.
Because Broadway is very demanding vocally.
I know. Have you noticed how much deeper my voice is since
I started?
This is just from talking for 2 weeks nonstop.
Okay. Good luck.
Thank you.
Good luck on Broadway.
Thanks,
good luck with G.I. Joe.
Thank you.
Good luck with everything.
Thanks,
it's
Matt.
It's nice to see you.
Nice
Welcome
to
back.
See you too.
G.I. Joe, Rise of Cobra opens.